Good morning, everyone.
So, Anushya, this is your first time to Hubli.
Yes,
yeah. It is. Yeah, very exciting pack 3 days for you.
Yes, it's been wonderful. I had a great start yesterday, arrived early morning and been on a world tour of meeting a lot of people, met some of the students and been to the sandbox center and wonderful experience so far.
So tell us a little bit about you as a child. I want to go back to the beginning. Where did you grow up?
I was born in Iran and raised in Iran until I was about 16 years old and left for the United States to continue my studies as I was graduating. When I was in Iran as a young child, I fell in love with the stars, sleeping outside, summer nights, looking at the night skies. It became a refuge for me where, you know, I could let my imagination go wild and imagine, you know, strange new worlds, places I could go and visit, and aliens who can come and take me with them to visit those worlds. So it became an amazing place for me to sort of exercise my mind, and that got me interested in math and sciences.
How to get to the moon,
exactly.
Really makes you do math and science.
Absolutely, space is an inspiring place for young kids to get interested in math and science, and I use that a lot nowadays to get them interested in that. And
I just want to tell you, like in India, you know, when you want to feed a child, you take them outside, show them the moon, and feed them, and it's shown a lot of times, like, you know, the man in the moon, or, you know, whatever. It's funny, someone commented to me, one of my American friends, when I took him to a music concert in U.S., he said a lot of Hindi songs seem to be everything about the moon, you know. Your face looks like the moonlit night, the moon, I mean, everything is about moon. So I think it features in our ethos a lot.
It is a beautiful, celestial object to look at, the closest to us, so we've idolized it for a long time.
Yeah. So you left Iran when you were 16 years old, and then you came to U.S., so you were pursuing math, sciences. So what did you study? Where did you actually go in U.S.?
So when I came, I actually thought, okay, this is my chance to become an astronaut, because growing up, that's all I wanted to do. And living through the revolution, through the war, and then coming to U.S., I thought, okay, this is my chance. I arrived to a country, I didn't speak English, I wasn't a citizen. It was after the hostage crisis, so Iran were not very popular. I'm still not very popular even today. But
where in U.S. did you land?
In Virginia. So I realized quickly that I have to be a little bit more practical. Even if I forgot about it, my mom made sure that she reminded me that this is a new place, new world. We're starting life over again with practically nothing. So, and I'm the eldest child in the family, so she said, you need to think about what you're going to study so you can get a job quickly, because that's how we're going to support the family.
And how many of you were there when you came?
So I came with my mom. I had a younger sister, 5 years younger, so we were all together, and my dad joined later on. But so I studied engineering. Electrical engineering was not my first choice, my second choice, but...
What was your first choice?
Astrophysics.
Not as many jobs in it.
No, so that's why my mom persuaded me electrical engineering would be a better choice. That's what I studied, and it proved to be the right choice for me, because it helped me.
Why did it prove to be the right choice for you?
Because I ended up building a career in telecom, and at the time telecom was a booming, you know, marketplace, and allowed me to start my company with my husband, and became very successful and became a path for making my other dreams come true.
But, you know, before we skip over the success, let's talk about the path it took to be success. It's you, your husband, your brother-in-law, it was sort of all eggs in one basket. So what was the company, and what was it like when you started? Because entrepreneurship is a great buzzword today, but at that time, even in US, it wasn't easy to do. So tell me a little bit of what is it that you were building, and what was it like in the initial stages?
So we started in 1993, and as you said, at that time, There were no such thing as Silicon Valley the way it exists today, and entrepreneurship was not this, you know, great, well-taught career path, if you would, if you can call it a career.
And you were in Dallas.
Yes, we had just moved to Dallas, part of it was because we were starting our company, and we ended up, a lot of our customers were in Dallas, so we thought we have to be close to our customers to be successful. So we all moved to Dallas, which was a big move for us, and started building the company basically with our savings, credit cards, juggling payroll from one credit card to another,
And what was the product? What was the company you were building?
We had done some consulting work individually, and we realized that a lot of the products and ideas that we're giving to the telecom operators, they like it, but they having a hard time building it. So we figured, well, maybe if we build it outside the bureaucracy of these large companies, it would make sense. So we started doing software development. So a lot of the products we came up with, we started building for them, from test automation, automating operator services, platforms. At the time, there were local number portability, which would allow people to keep their number and move from, you know, one operator to another. So we were at the early days of that, early days of building data networks, all of those wireless networks. So a lot of products in those areas, we started building the software for it, and eventually built the software for which is called SoftSwitch, which enables voice over IP, which today everyone uses it. But back then it was like no one even thought about using IP networks for voice communication.
You know, one of the things I want to ask you about, I mean, in general, I think in our lifetime, especially for you coming from Iran to US and, you know, this arc of development, we've seen the technology go from, you know, operator place trunk calls that would take, you had to wait 2 days by the telephone to answer, to instant switches, you know, instant connections, etc. So what was it like to actually dream in that? Because as you said, voice over IP, all these things are commonplace today, but to think about it before it was popular and to sell it, sell that dream to someone that yes, it can be. So can you recall, like, what are the things, was there a tough customer sale? What, how did you get someone to look at a possibility that doesn't exist?
So since then we've built a lot of companies, but every time we're building something, usually it's sort of a transformational service or product or concept where usually we're called crazy. The first instance is when you talk to someone, they look at you kind of funny, they look at you like, you know, what have you been smoking, basically.
Then you know you're on the right path.
Then you know, yeah, we must be doing something right. The point is not to be afraid to risk, and you know, if you believe in something. And it's not to say that you will always succeed, but at least, you know, if you have done your work, if you've studied the problem, and you understand the problem you're trying to solve, then you're bound to find the right solution. And the solution will transform, so it's also important not to be in love with your solution, but, you know, as people say, be in love with the problem that you're trying to solve. So in a lot of what we've done, we've looked at a problem that exists or problem that is about to happen, and trying to find a solution for that. And you know, it requires people to have a vision to see that, and sometimes it's difficult to make the sale. So usually our sales cycles tend to be long in our company. We're very patient, but it proves to be the right thing to do, and so far it's been proven successful for us.
So after building it for how many years that you actually had an exit?
We worked basically for 8 years. I mean, 8 grueling years. We had no breaks, no holidays, you know, 7 a.m. to, you know, 8, 9 p.m., if not longer. And we basically dedicated everything to the company. And I work with my husband, which is good and bad. Most people don't understand how we work together, but, you know,
and then live together.
And live together. But, you know, our life becomes our work in a way. And it's basically putting everything you have in your work, and that becomes your tribe, something that you see it from the beginning, you grow it and you nurture it, and basically our employees became our children and our family, extended family.
Yeah, you know, my husband and I never worked together before because I was at Intel, he was at AMD, we're like arch enemies, right? But now we are for the first time working together. So the other day, my 12-year-old son says, it's not fun anymore. You know, now we all you talk about is work all the time. You know, so he's put a moratorium when we go out, when we are in the car, that for the next 2 hours, you cannot talk work. You know? So it's sort of, I think it becomes, you know, part and parcel of you. And the interesting thing, I actually talked to your husband about this as well, is that a lot of people talk about work-life balance and the relative recognition each one gets, etc. And you always be in the face of everything that you do. And his attitude was like, oh, so much better for me. But how was it like, I mean, did you have, even within your family or, you know, anybody saying, you as a woman, you are the front face and your husband and your brother-in-law supporting you from behind, which I think is fantastic. But did you have anybody say why is it so, or was it a very natural progression? I mean, obviously we're a very strong mother, so.
Yeah, no, I think it. My husband is also my mentor, actually. When I started working in telecom, I had just graduated from school, and my brother-in-law went to school with me. So he told me, there's an opening at the company. My brother works, why don't you apply for a summer internship? And I did, and I ended up working for my husband there. And he actually taught me a lot. He taught me public speaking. I hated public speaking. He taught me how to make presentations. A lot of skills that actually students are learning as part of the, you know, the, being part of the sandbox and learning a lot of these skills. I didn't have any of these skills, and it's very, very important. So he taught me a lot. I've always been trying to put him in front, but he's happy where he is. And,
so did he ever fire you to marry you?
We had to quit, but yes, because we both worked for MCI at that time, and so we left the company before.
Started something on your own.
Yeah, we worked out.
Yeah. So, you know, after you had financial success, you know, when the company exited, tell us a little bit about the exit and what was it like to, after 8 grueling years, to get some kind of a relief?
Huge relief. So it was right at the, you know, big boom of the internet and the dot-com boom, they called it. It was before the bust. Right before the bust. And we were preparing to go public. And at that part of that process, we got offers to, you know, acquire the company. And we started entertaining some of them, because at the end of the day, I was looking at how much fun we had. You talked about the journey.
Right.
And building the company was an amazing journey for us. It was a kind of experience we've never had before, and we loved it and enjoyed every bit of it. And we felt that, you know, we probably would enjoy that part of the journey more than taking it to the next stage and being part of a public company. So we thought that may be a good idea, and we entertained it and sold the company. And it was very difficult, the whole negotiation and going through that process, because I had two very, very close people in my life who became very, very ill right in the middle of the whole process of negotiation. And I lost both of them. Right there. So it was a very difficult time for me, but I also felt that this is not just my company. Everyone who spent their life and dedicated every moment of their time to it were counting on me to be there and do my best. So I did that, and we successfully merged with Sonos Network, and the company became part of that. And of course, a few months later, the whole world turned upside down, and we had to deal with a lot of challenges after that. So I stayed with the company for another 2 years and worked there.
Now we come to the part where, you know, how your childhood dream has resurfaced again. So the thing that's great about dreams is that if you don't give up, at some point they come true. So you wanted to go up in space, you know, maybe as a NASA astronaut, but you had an opportunity again to do that, and this time, because of the financial success that you had, you could actually take a huge, you know, gamble, so to speak, and put that. And just a quick background is that, you know, Peter Diamandis is someone who started XPRIZE, and his idea was that if you create a prize for a big challenge, the amount of money that's spent in the ecosystem will be much larger than the prize amount. And so to move the needle on any idea, you should declare a huge prize. So he was a lone man, a warrior, and he came up and he wanted to do a space prize, and you stepped forward. So tell me a little bit about what the prize was and what made you in those days bet $10 million on it.
So Peter, who's an amazing person, and hopefully you get to meet him at the Singularity University when you're hosting. He had read a book that a friend gave him about the prize that made Lindbergh fly nonstop from New York to Paris, which started the whole aviation industry. He talked about, you know, doing the same thing for space industry, because he also wanted to go to space, and like me, didn't get to be an astronaut. So he started it, but you know, he was also called crazy. Who would build a spaceship in their garage to go up there?
Yeah, and the thing was, it can't be government supported. Yeah. It has to be built privately. So tell a little bit about
So the prize idea was a $10 million prize for anyone who could build a spaceship to go to space, to edge of space, twice within 2 weeks. And the twice within 2 weeks was, so it's not a science project. It would be something that's sustainable. It could fly multiple times, and it would be cost effective. And that was an idea that was, you know, really far-fetched at that time, and not having government support and building spaceships in your garage, you know, even today if you tell someone, they will tell
and
you.
That was which year?
That was in, I think he announced it around 2000.
Okay. Yeah.
And
how did you hear about it and decide to?
So we had just sold the company, and we took like a 3 month sabbatical to, and we went to Hawaii for a while to just relax with the family. And my assistant kept calling me and said, this guy keeps calling and calling, he wants to meet you. And I asked him, what is it about? It was about space. And I said, of course, just first meeting when I come back. So Peter had read one of my interviews and my passion for space, and made it his mission to meet with me. When I came back, we met, and he made the pitch about the idea, and immediately, I mean, his passion and his belief in this idea was contagious, and I've been looking for a way to find my way of making my dream come true. And when I talked to him, I figured this is the way. This is the way that I'm going to get to experience space. And immediately became part of the team and supported him throughout this whole journey and building XPRIZE Foundation, which now actually, you know, we have competitions, because the competition model worked in 2004. The prize was won, and it kick-started this whole new age of space industries in US.
And with SpaceX, with the lot of things, yeah.
Yeah, so a lot of companies now are building hardware with transport, NASA, and the way they interact with the private industry, and the cost of access to space has come down, which really makes a huge difference for us here on Earth, because we really benefit from this type of research and work that can be done in space. And it's been wonderful to see that transformation, and how now we have prizes that will be addressing other big challenges, from energy, poverty, education. We have prizes that we've announced in all of these areas, and we have many teams, actually students from India, competing in a lot of those prizes, and we're very excited about what's happening right now.
So we'll actually, instead of talking about it, we'll show a little video, and you can talk about it, about the Ansari XPRIZE and how it was won, and how did your dream finally come true. So can we roll the video, please? And do you want the sound to be muted so you can talk?
No, I
okay.
Can talk over. Ever since I remember as a child in Iran, sleeping under the stars and watching if the stars twinkle, it was something that I wanted to experience for myself.
Can everybody hear it?
Yeah.
The mystery and the unknown out there always have been drawing me to space. The universe is calling me.
I'm sorry.
I'm not afraid of risk. This is a risk worth taking. And having the view we saw today on the monitors of Spaceship One, just an experience that's out of this world, and I would do anything, give my life to experience. Early days of XPRIZE, and this design was actually commercialized by Richard Branson into Virgin Galactic, which will fly passengers in 2018 to experience space. Then I ended up training as a cosmonaut for a year in Russia to go to International Space Station. This is part of the making of a seat liner. When you fly in Soyuz, they actually cast the seat liner to protect you during your landing. These are all part of the training program and the preparation for the flight. This is a centrifuge training. You get to experience G-forces here, doing the G-force of 9 Gs. It makes it very difficult to breathe, so you can see my face out. Part of the training, this is a Soyuz simulation area. You get to practice many different scenarios. It's a tiny capsule that is 3 people. This is part of the survival training in case you land someplace where it will be difficult to get to you, so you can survive for a couple of days. And this is the space station training facilities where you get to hours of simulation. This is a zero-G flight, the most fun part of the training. You can actually experience this if you're in the US, you can do a zero-G flight there now. I had to learn Russian because all the instruments and everything and the manuals are in Russian. And this was our final exam. These are my 2 crewmates I flew with. Mikhail Turin was the Soyuz commander from Russia, and Michael Lopez Alegria was the NASA astronaut and the flight engineer.
So just because you gave the prize, you couldn't automatically go, you had to pass the test.
No free passes. This is part of the ceremonial warning of the flights. You ask for permission to board the rocket, and then you're driven to the rocket and ride a small elevator to the top where the capsule sits. One of the most exciting time of my life. And my family came out to watch the launch.
I mean, your families have been petrified, right?
I mean, to see who they were. You can see it in their faces.
Yeah.
This is when the countdown started. Inside the couch. This is my husband.
Especially for your mother, you know. I mean, on one hand, her baby's dream is coming true. On the other hand, there's no telling what happens when you go up there. So how was it for your family?
It was a very difficult time. My mom, I tell people, she was on tranquilizer. Literally, she was taking medication that will keep her calm. And she would come out and, you know, do the ceremonies and cry and then again take some pills so she would stay calm. But what was important that she realized how important this was for me, because she had heard me talk about going to space when I was, you know, very, very young. And she never told me once that, oh, this is too dangerous, don't do it. And I listened to my mom a lot, but she never took advantage of that, her position as my mother. And she was very supportive and just said, you know, I know that I'll pray for you. I know you'll come back to me safe.
So how many days was it, the whole journey?
I spent 2 days in the capsule, so it took 2 days at that time, the journey to International Space Station. and then 9 days on board the space station. So total of 11 amazing, wonderful, life-changing days.
So what's the one thing that you remember? I mean, as you were finally your dream is coming true. You are up there. You're looking at Earth from up there. What was it like?
It's a very emotional experience.
Did you cry? I mean, what was your reaction?
I did. So I was in the capsule. I remember it vividly. I was in the capsule. They had just allowed us to open our belts. So I started slowly floating up to a window that was next to me. And for the first time, I saw Earth with my own eyes. And I mean, I was overwhelmed with emotions. I started crying. And you know, one of my teardrops started floating right in front of me, and that made me really—it looked really strange to me. So I started laughing, but I felt this warmth and energy that is really difficult to describe when I was looking at Earth, and it makes you look at the whole life differently, because you see this precious thing out there that it's beautiful and there's nothing else like it around. And you see this blackness of space around it, and you see this very, very thin line, this thin blue glow around our planet. And that's the difference between life and death. That's the only reason there's life on our planet. And this little thin atmosphere, which is the size of the skin of an apple, if you compare the Earth to an apple, is what we really take for granted and harm our planet in ways that we don't even understand the consequences. And you have to be out there and look back at it to really realize it. And that's one of the reasons I hope that more people get to experience space, because it really changes the way you look at your environment, your life, what's important.
So the journey after that is that Virgin Galactic has decided to commercialize it. You know, that whole experiment went into Virgin Galactic. And they had a failure recently when they launched, which is obviously expected. What do you think the next journey is going to be? I mean, do you really think by 2018 we are going to be able to take space tourists? What do you, with the SpaceX, with the Virgin Galactic, with all the things that are going on, what do you think?
I think, this whole space industry has started its transformational phase. And what excites me is, being part of telecom, as you mentioned, when I started my career, making a long distance call costs about like $1 to $2, and very, very expensive. And then as competition grew, and with voice over IP technology and how it has transformed telecom, now it's practically free. We call all over the world, not just long distance, but international calls for next to nothing. And I see the same thing could happen in space with enough competition. The cost of access to space, which is the biggest barrier of innovation in space, is starting to go down with what SpaceX is doing, with a lot of companies that are coming online, building technology for access to space. That cost is coming down, which gives us an opportunity to do a lot of innovation in space. One of the projects I'm very excited about is solar panel satellites, where you can have solar panels in space collecting the energy of the sun continuously, without the clouds, the day and night cycle, and then beaming down to a power station where they can be distributed clean, safe, low-cost energy access to everyone. There are lots of opportunities to do medical research in space, for new material, new medication, all sorts of different things which we've benefited all throughout these years from that. But now that the magnitude of innovation can increase because of reduction in cost. And it's already happening. I can see, we will have, definitely permanent base on the moon, and we will reach out to Mars. The cost of people flying suborbital will come down in a few thousand, just like early days of airplanes, where it cost a lot of money, not everyone could do it. It will take maybe 20, 30, 50 years, but the cost will come down.
I hope it's shorter than that so I can go on it.
You can today.
I don't have a huge exit to do that. No, I think also the thing I want to also bring out in what you did is that, when people acquire wealth, we always think of purchasing products. You know, people, I always tell my friends that they'll drop a few lakhs on buying a piece of jewelry or a sari, but to spend it on an experience, it's always difficult for people to. But it's the experience is the only thing you take with you to the grave. I mean, that moment of looking at Earth from up there, you couldn't have paid enough to have that with you for the rest of your life. You know, and that's the thing I love about your story. That's why wherever I go, I drag and I'm ashamed to tell the story, is because I think that experience is really, really wonderful. And you're actually, I think your perspective of giving back has also obviously continued. So with the success that you had, you're actually putting it back, your technology, into serving the people so they can have access to internet, etc. So tell us a little bit about, I mean, much to my delight, you're spending a lot of time in India. Mm-hmm. So, and you're doing some work in Rajasthan. So tell me about that.
Sure. Just on experience, I believe life is about experiences. Yeah. And you know, we really make out how we live through these small, big experiences that we have. So, and my husband tells me I have a very expensive hobby, which means that we had to start another company, and we're you know, right now the seventh year of our new company, Prodia. And what I'm doing in India is I've been coming here since 2005, and I've seen how the country is being transformed, and this new young energy that's transforming the country. And growing up, my father loved India and got me familiar with Indian music and Bollywood, going as a child to theaters in Tehran, watching Bollywood movies. So, sort of...
Raj Kapoor is very famous everywhere,
Raj Kapoor,
right?
of course. So when I came here in 2005 and then over the years came here, I saw this transformation. And I wanted to be part of that and contribute. I've been supporting social entrepreneurs for many years, and recently have turned into one, which is wonderful. And we're using our technology and partnering with the Tata Trust in using the technology to create a distribution network to rural India, where products and services from entrepreneurs that we saw here on stage today and out there in the audience, one of their biggest challenges, access to their audience and how to deliver their products.
Very few people on the internet today. Yeah.
Absolutely. So we're using the TV, which is something that already exists in most of the households, or people have access to it in the rural area. And you know, it breaks the barriers of literacy and technophobia, and the fact that they're afraid of even technology, or they don't even understand sometimes why they would need the internet, what good will it do for them. And we realized that, you know, internet connectivity exists, there are 3G network in most of the villages, but no one was using it. So we turned the TV into an interactive screen where we're delivering services curated for a TV screen where they can use a remote control, not keyboard and mouse. So it's very easy and simple for them to identify what they need and navigate through the system. And we're delivering government benefits and services, health and education material in multiple languages, allowing for them to see the status of a grievance that they've you know, filed, and interacting in many different ways, having an e-wallet so they can do commercial transactions. And all of these true partnerships, we're not building any of the services, we're not creating any of the content, just creating the network infrastructure that they can deliver these services. So I'm looking for partners. If there are people in the audience who would like to partner with us, definitely come and see me afterwards, because we're very excited about it. We just launched in November.
How many villages, how many people are you?
So we're starting in Rajasthan in 3 districts, Jaipur, Sikar and Ajmer, and we're planning to be in about 100,000 homes by end of the year, and growing it from there to different states across India. So you know,
what is the model? Is it a subscription model? Do people have to pay monthly, or is the government subsidizing it? Are you subsidizing it?
So we, the whole project is based on a sustainable model, but we're putting the you know, system and providing about 1 gig of data for the first year as part of introduction of this to people, so they can start using it. But then the services and transactions actually have some fees associated with them. And that's how we will make the whole product sustainable over time. And to me, it's not a choice of either or. I think, you know, we can spend money on, you know, always feeding and then making someone very full and so they're not hungry. But I think there's always a great advantage in also feeding the mind, feeding the aspiration that someone has, and looking forward to something that they can do that's beyond possible or what seems to be possible. So those things is what makes life complete, not something that's just in front of us. I do work in both areas. I think having the ability to travel to space will be better for humanity, maybe not in short term, and perhaps like Sam's visionary work, which maybe at the time people told him, why are you spending the money where you're spending? And today we're appreciating what he's doing. In, you know, 20, 30, 50 years, so people will look back and say the investment that was made is what making life sustainable on our planet. So it's about a vision and something we'll perhaps see in, you know, many years from now, and we can have this debate when we get to be in future and look back.
And also I feel great solutions come when you try multiple things, you know. Everybody feels that they figured out exactly how to have it, and we need to let everyone do their thing. Otherwise, one point of view will not get us to where we want to get to. I would rather have someone spend $10 million to go to space than buy a $10 million home, you know. I mean, to me, that's much better. So I think experiences and pushing yourself beyond human imagination is important for everyone to see, because it makes them dream bigger, and that's the only way we can innovate.
So definitely mentorship plays a big role, because you have that one person that you over time create a trust with, and they can you can go to them with your most difficult, you know, questions and things that you may not feel comfortable sharing with other people that happen to be your friend or your colleague. So there's a lot of different organizations that provide mentorship just because of that, and I think it's very valuable. But I've also seen people succeed without mentor. So instead of having one single person like that, you become part of networks of people, colleagues, individuals who either are going through the same type of activity or struggles that you're going, so you can share your thoughts and experiences together, or you know, people who have done it and are providing, you know, some sort of like these types of conferences where you get to meet and network with people who can help you in specific areas that you're interested to do so. And definitely very, very helpful and recommended, but it's not the only way to get to where you want to get to.
So that's supposed to be the last question, and I always like to end with a story. Actually, that's a perfect segue into wrapping it up. This is a story of, you know, Kamra Nilayan is our common friend who actually introduced me to Anushe. We were partners in a venture fund, and I went to him like 15 years ago, and I think I've always been looking for a mentor. I want you to be my mentor. This was like at 8:30 in the evening at work, and he says, okay, sit down. So I sit down, and he tells me this story. And this is a story I carry with me forever and ever. And this is a story of a wee boy who goes to the zoo, and he sees there's a huge elephant there, which is tied to a small pole by a very thin chain. And the elephant is looking very sad. And the little boy asks the zookeeper, why is the elephant sad? And the zookeeper says, because, you know, the forest out there, the elephant really wants to be out in the forest. It doesn't want to be here. And the boy says, what's stopping the elephant? You know, the chain is very thin. The stick is very small. All it has to do is move its head and it'll be out there. And the fence is very low. The zookeeper says, aha, but when the elephant first came here 5 years ago, the pole was this huge, the chain was this thick, the fence was this high, and the elephant tried to get away over and over and over for 10 days, and it just couldn't get away, and it just gave up. It just figured that it can't get away because it's tried then. It hasn't seen how big it has become. And what Kamran told me is that you want me to be your mentor, but the real thing you need to think about is that you have the power to go out and do whatever you want to do. That mentor is within you, and you can actually become a mentor for someone else. The fact that we are looking for a mentor already says you've come to a stage you don't need one anymore. And to me, after this many years in US to come back here, I see that possibility in India. I think India is that big elephant that doesn't know how powerful it is. And I think the younger people, all of you, don't know how powerful you are. I mean, I hire people who are half my age because they are twice as smart, and I learn from them. I'm petrified of them. I'm scared to present any idea because they just like rip it apart, and there are 20 reasons why I'm wrong. So I think you, who's looking for a mentor, is actually capable of being a mentor to someone else. So I really submit to all of you young people, instead of somehow wanting some mentor to come and change things for you, find that within yourself. And actually you can help a lot of people around you, people like me. So thank you very much, Anushin. Thank you so much.